Hello and welcome to the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Friends. Apologies for the late start. Today is Thursday, October the 15th, and we are delighted that you've decided to join us on what will be a slightly abbreviated program due to the late start that we got off to. I am Leon Wolf, your host, and I'd like to invite all of you to greet my regular panelists and thank them for their time for sticking in with us in spite of the delay. First of all, we have Jeff Blehar of the Ace of Spades Decision Desk, F. Bill McMorris of the Washington Free Beacon, Becket Adams of the Washington Examiner. Both of them are Mets fans, and so therefore are quite possibly watching their TV right now, but we're glad they're going to be here. And joining us again after a lengthy hiatus, we're delighted to have him back on the show, Senator Ted Cruz from Texas. Thank you for joining us, Senator Cruz.
Screw you, Leon. Screw you.
We're glad to have you back.
He has a gun.
Brandishing a gun in true Texan fashion. Our guest for tonight is Brent Cochran of the I'm sorry, Brent, can you repeat that for me again? The Drift
Compatible Podcast.
The Drift Compatible Podcast. We know him from Ace of Spades Decision Desk and from being some jerk who's always chiming in on Twitter conversations. We're glad to have you with us, Brent. We're going to get right into the news of the day. We're going to talk a little bit, first of all, about the Democrat debate. First Democrat debate that happened on Tuesday night. As slow and painful and terrible as it was. Brent, what do you think? As the guest on the show, you get the first question. Who won the debate in your mind?
I guess you have to say Hillary won the casting call for the remake of Cocoon, mostly because everybody seemed to defer to her. You had Bernie Sanders defending her, and you know we've heard enough about her damn emails. I don't think I've ever seen that before in a debate, to have one of your opponents actually come out that stridently. It was awful. I mean, to try and watch that, it lasted forever. It was quite literally a bunch of old white people on stage sounding and looking like a bunch of old white people. You know, if I was a Democrat and I was looking at that, there's just not a lot to get excited about there. But if you got to give it to somebody, then you're probably going to give it to Hillary.
So Jeff, let me go to you, and let's riff off of that, the point that Brent just made, that one of the things, kind of the most memorable moment of the debate, was essentially Bernie sticking up from Hillary. And I have to disagree somewhat with Brent, because we have seen this before, right? I mean, back in 2012, Newt Gingrich essentially catapulted himself to prominence by defending the other Republicans in the stage from some absurd questions from the media.
Sure.
Do you think that same kind of thing will work with the Democrat dynamic? I mean, there definitely is a core of Hillary supporters who believe that Hillary is treated unfairly by the media, as absurd as that may seem.
Oh, absolutely it will work, and that's precisely what was happening there. And in fact, I mean, that was what I said literally at the time that it happened. No Democrat who actually wants to seriously get Democratic primary votes is going to go after Hillary for her scandals, which is one of the reasons why she's sort of impregnable. You can't really get her on, like, Benghazi. A Democrat who brought up that in a Democratic debate would be, you know, just booed out of the building, in the same way that when people went after Mitt Romney for his business record in the Republican primary debates, they immediately began to plunge, no matter how popular they might have been up until that point, because it was just seen as parroting the talking points of the left in the mainstream media. Well, in this case, you're parroting the talking points of the right. And believe it or not, the left has their own narrative about how the mainstream media is against them. As ridiculous as that seems, believe me, you spend enough time talking to these people, and it's something that they hold really near and dear to their heart. I guess they're just not socialist enough for their tastes. So it was very much the right thing to do. And in fact, I've been paying attention to reports back from focus groups, it played very well. Bernie Sanders actually gained on that exchange by white knighting, as the term is used on the internet, white knighting for Hillary, which is very problematic, I suppose, you know, a man standing up for a woman, but it played well. And that was the only smart play for anybody who wants to seriously challenge Clinton to do, is to not engage her on those grounds. But I have to disagree with Brent. I think that the obvious winner of last night's debate was Lincoln Chafee. For the simple reason that every one of us, when we saw Lincoln Chafee speak, thought, holy shit, I want to see some more of that, because that was just so hilariously, unbelievably awful. He was magnetic in his terribleness. He was sort of the anti-Trump, a black hole of charisma from whose gaping maw no talent or ability can ever escape. It was just fantastic referral. Rand Paul had competence on his side. Lincoln Chafee couldn't think his way out of a barf bag. It was just incredible. I think he was the hands-down winner of that debate.
And you know what I have to say to that? Democrats, he's your problem now.
Yeah.
You know, I thank God. Before Tuesday night's debate, I was probably one of the 10 people in America who lives outside of Rhode Island who had ever seen Lincoln Chafee on television before. And I tweeted before the debate, y'all have no idea of what's coming right now because it's going to be awesome and awful. And I'm so glad that America finally got to see just how stupid Lincoln Chafee is. It's astonishing in its own way.
This man was shoeing horses in Bozeman, Montana before he suddenly decided he was bored being a farrier and came back to be working in Rhode Island politics with his dad. And then he got jumped up into the Senate, you know, basically because he was, you know, it was pure nepotism. And it shows.
Because he's a block of granite, Jeff.
Yeah.
What I loved about Lincoln Chafee, and we're going to get to Neal here in a second, what I loved about Lincoln Chafee was that every time somebody mentioned his name, just the most obvious look of, I'm on TV, jumped over his face. I'm going to be on TV, Mom. All right, so Neal, what do you think? You agree that Hillary won the debate? What's your take on winners and losers on the Democrat side?
Yes, Hillary definitely won, in large part because Bernie Sanders single-handedly relinquished any chance he might have had of actually harming her. That was very strange. It makes me wonder what he got in return, because he was the one person who was positioned on that stage to actually go after Hillary for her ethical violations as it regards her emails, and he intentionally diffused it. So either he has made the calculation that I have no chance, Hillary's going to win, and so I should really probably not burn any bridges here, or he's just a doddering old fool. Either one seems likely to me. So yes, Hillary definitely won. Now, alternate theory, Joe Biden won because nobody on that stage was terribly impressive. I mean, Hillary was just basically handed everything, as she's been handed her entire public career, actually, so it was sort of in keeping with history. But, so Joe Biden wants to get in. I think he will actually be judged the retroactive winner of that debate.
So, Bill, let me go to you next. Would you agree with Neal? I mean, what do you think? You think that what happened on the debate stage Tuesday makes Joe Biden more likely or less likely to enter the race?
Oh, man. When I'm analyzing the debate, all I can think about is that I didn't watch one fucking second of it because I was watching the Mets game, the real action of the night, which is exactly what I'm doing right now. Fuck you, Granky, which is exactly what I'm doing right now. And yeah, I'm probably not going to pay much attention to this show. And I'm with Becket right now. We're just hanging out, watching the game. Don't call on us again. But we're going to live stream it. We're going to live stream it so you guys can watch two grown men cry if everything goes to shit.
Wait. Is like Beckett's not there in the room with you, is he?
No, he literally is. They're on the same couch.
Yeah, this is the same couch. Beckett's just not taking up as much room as I am, so it's hard to tell.
Was this planned or was this a last minute thing?
This was totally planned, man. Check it out. I got it all right here. Whoa, my buttons just went everywhere. Woo! Go Mets! Baba Booey, we're gonna win. Daniel Murphy's gonna be series MVP. You're welcome, everybody, for all the internet hits.
Hey, are you caught up now on the game? So can I continue to?
Yeah, because you guys fucking told me the score. I had to fast forward through the game. Really appreciated that.
So Becket, you got any? You got any thoughts on Joe Biden?
Hillary won the debate.
Circling back to it,
Becket, what do you think? Biden more likely or less likely to enter the race after the debate?
I mean, honestly, I think one of the interesting things about all of this is that. The press, it's funny watching how the polling came out afterwards, because I'm sure you guys noticed this, everyone in the press was saying Hillary clearly won, but you look at any polls, I know online polls are obviously unscientific, but I thought it was still an interesting disconnect. You see everyone was saying, by and large, Bernie Sanders was the clear winner of the evening. You saw that with the Frank Lutz group. You saw this with, like, the Drudge poll. Again, extremely unscientific, as we know from Trump regularly citing it. But one of the things I think is interesting in all of this is that the press is saying, you know what, that was his window, and she did so well, it's probably closed at this point. I don't know if I necessarily agreed with that, but I would just say the sort of, not fervor, but the sort of drumbeat of let's get Biden seems to have calmed a bit in just a short amount of time. Does he jump in? At this point, I would be interested if the president took an executive order banning stories talking about him maybe jumping in. I don't want to hear about it until he actually makes up his damn mind on this. At this point, like, I think, who was it? I think it was Rick Wilson said it well this morning. He was talking about how there's this sort of Hamlet fiasco going on where they're just constantly agonizing over it. At this point, does he jump in? There's support for it, but after the debate, I mean, I think she did pretty well. She skated by. She found absolutely no opposition. It was amazing to watch all the layups and softballs she got from men who were supposed to be competing with her. If Joe Biden wants to jump in, which I don't think he – I think he's got room for it, but it doesn't seem as big right now as it did prior, if that makes any sense. I know that was a little rambling.
Can we spare a word of sadness, by the way, for Jim Webb, who he seemed like a sad Martian or like a man who like in some sort of reverse Back to the Future teleported in from 1988.
And Jim Webb was – he was the only guy on stage who occasionally gave the air of someone who actually knew what he was talking about, but he ruined it by every time they called on him complaining about, I haven't been getting enough time.
Hey, Leon, the man can't help it. He was born fighting, okay?
He did pitch him on, and it came off, it was awfully unbecoming. It would have worked if he did it maybe once, maybe twice, but, like, yeah, Leon, you're right. Every time he opened his mouth, it was to bitch about his time, which, yeah, it came off as unbecoming, but I think, just to kind of play off what Jeff is saying here, I think Leon... Jim Webb's story out of all this is just, especially the treatment in the press afterwards, the sort of weird sneering at him, especially when, as you guys all remember, the moment when they were asked to list their enemies, and he mentioned his combat service as a United States Marine in fucking Vietnam, pardon my French, and he had all these reporters kind of sneering at him, like, oh, this war story, and amazing. I mean, I don't know if you guys have been. Have any of you guys ever been to a VFW and had a couple beers with vets or anything? Has anyone ever
done that? I have.
Have you guys ever heard a vet tell a war story? There's nothing unusual or weird or creepy, as Ken Vogel at Politico referred to it. I kind of felt bad for the guy, because here's someone who literally was wounded in battle, saving someone else, taking a grenade for someone else, and then mentioning that, and he had this kind of look on his face like, yeah, they didn't get me. And then people just kind of made fun of him for it. For me, I thought it was an upsetting moment. Disgusting.
Brent, are you still with us?
I am. Can you hear me?
Yeah. So let's talk a little bit about, kind of the expectations game versus what we would normally expect to see. And one of the things that's interesting was... after the first Republican debate, everybody said, look, Donald Trump got a clock cleaned. He made an ass out of himself. He's now – this boom that he's enjoyed in the polls is going to flatten out. And instead, the exact opposite of that happens. And I think it's reflective of the fact that the voters are not behaving in ways that they traditionally have, and they're not perceiving things as they normally would have. And I think that everybody more or less agrees that on an objective level, Hillary had the best performance of the night. But, what do you think is going to happen in the polls? I mean – will the Democrat voters agree with that analysis, or are we going to see, kind of Bernie Sanders unexpectedly move up in spite of the fact that he didn't really accomplish anything of note in the course of the debate?
Honestly, I don't think we're going to see much movement at all. I think everybody's going to hold pretty firm. Hillary didn't hurt herself. I don't think she's going to lose any ground because of her performance. And I don't think there's a lot of ground for Sanders to Doc Brown to make up. I don't know who he's pulling from, maybe from Lincoln Chafee, but what's he going to get, a percentage, maybe two from Link? He's not carrying that much. I just don't know if there's a whole lot of room to move there. If there is, then yeah, maybe Bernie does. Bernie would be the one that I would guess if anybody's going to move that he would go up from that performance.
So, Jeff, let's talk a little bit about the Republican side while we're on kind of the 2016 news here. And as we've seen, as I just mentioned to Brent, the Republican polls are behaving in ways that we wouldn't normally expect. I think coming out of the last debate, everybody agreed that probably Fiorina and Rubio helped themselves the most in the debate, and they have indeed gotten some some decent bumps polling-wise. But what we've seen kind of surprisingly is that Ben Carson has been the guy who's been benefited the most and has kind of moved himself into a tie with Donald Trump. What do you think about this news that's coming out now that he's – and there are conflicting reports as to what exactly it means, but he's basically taking time out of his campaign appearance schedule to do his book tour. I mean, ordinarily this would be something that would be kind of a death knell for folks, and I wrote about that today. It shows somebody who's not serious about their campaign at this stage to be taking time out to do a book tour when he's just now caught Trump. Do you think that's something that's going to hurt him, though? I mean, can we predict that at this point?
No, I think actually I have slowly and painfully, especially in the denouement after the second debate where everyone expected Trump's numbers to fall more than they did, I have concluded that we are through the looking glass here at this point, and that it would just be sort of classic establishment arrogance for me to assume that the rules are going to be played that the way they used to be. I mean, until such time as they are. And in that case, I'll concede that, like, okay, the laws of political gravity do still apply. But for now, I tend to think, no, that may not be the case. I am genuinely now conceiving of a world in which we nominate, God help me, Donald Trump or Ben Carson, neither of which will do anything except be absolutely obliterated and destroyed by Hillary Clinton in a general election, causing massive down-ticket losses, perhaps jeopardizing the House of Representatives, certainly losing us the Senate. And I cannot sit back and say glibly that, oh, well, that's not going to happen. Cooler minds are going to prevail. I do not think that Ben Carson taking time off to do his book tour is going to harm him in the slightest. And I think one of the reasons why it's not, and this is something that I was talking about, Al Pundit actually on Hot Air quoted me in a piece of his today as well. This all dates back
to...
Name check. But the original sin was the GOP fighting the last war, which is to say we scheduled debates this cycle on the basis of 2012. In 2012, there was one credible candidate running. Rick Perry might have been a second one, but he got in late and clearly he flamed out early. It was Mitt Romney or go home, and we had 400 debates. At this point, we had already had 8 debates. There would be 12 more. At this point in the current cycle, with all of these high-quality candidates running in a huge and fractured field for an open seat, we have had 3 debates. We will only have 6 more. It is irresponsible to have scheduled the debates in such a way as basically what the Democrats did. The Democrats were smart. They realized they only had one credible candidate, Hillary Clinton. So Debbie Wasserman Schultz, who's in the tank for Hillary, said, fuck it. I'm not going to listen to what Bernie Sanders or Martin O'Malley won. I'm going to schedule 4 debates, and if they don't like it, they can kiss my ass. It was the right move for her, and most likely for the Democratic Party as well, because she's going to be the nominee. It doesn't make any sense to give her more opportunities for her to injure herself. It was exactly the opposite logic that should have been used in scheduling debates this time. And because it's been a month and a half between each of these debates, and they're the only place where non-Trump, non-Carson candidates can seemingly grab any oxygen whatsoever, they've been dying on the vine, despite their good performances. Carly and Rubio, if they had had like a good debate and then a week break and then they come back and they have another good debate, you would see them climbing in the polls. But a month and a half later is the next time they appear. It's on CNBC. Everyone will have forgotten at that point. This really, I lay this at the feet of Reince Priebus and all the people at the RNC who made these calls. They royally fucked up, and there needs to be a reckoning about this in the future.
So Neal, let me go to you. And of course, today is a deadline for campaigns to announce their quarterly fundraising totals. And we had some relatively surprising news with the information that Ben Carson, I guess, ran away with the fundraising lead with the $20 million haul. Second place, Jeb Bush, around $13.5 million. Third place, you, Ted Cruz, with about $12 million. Fiorina and Rubio at about $6 million each, and then Christie at $4.5 million, Rand Paul $2.5 million, others much less. Mm-hmm. So what do you make of this news? Obviously, Jeb with a second place haul isn't as dead as maybe we thought he was, but still lower than the expectations would have been. Does anybody win the the expectations game with respect to fundraising, besides Ben Carson?
Quick question. This money, is it total funds? Is it donated to super PACs?
This is actual direct contributions to the campaign.
To the
actual camp. So right.
My God, imagine how much money was sent to those fake out campaigns, the ones that say, you know, they're all pro Ben Carson and preying on everyone's grandmother and grandfather. That's interesting that Ben Carson pulled in so much. I'm not exactly sure what to make of it. I want to revisit, though, something that Jeff said earlier about conceiving a world in which Donald Trump is the nominee. I think his demeanor is a little bit too grim. He's too dour, because I think he forgets that America has a rich history of producing deranged madmen who gun down populist candidates for high office. So that could happen. Let's not discount the possibility that some crazy could save the Republic.
Does anyone have anything they would like to add on the actual question, which was about the fundraising numbers that came out today? Beckett, you're actually sitting at your computer.
I just want to say everybody needs to be looking at Bill's camera right now because it's just awesome. Because we can see Bill sitting with Beckett, and I assume that's Bill's wife there, and they're all watching the game. It's like a very intimate view into the world of fancy Bill McMorris.
Fancy Bill. I love it.
I mean, the brief thing that I was able to, I didn't get a whole lot of time to digest a lot of the FEC numbers, but the thing that I thought was interesting, obviously, is Jeb Bush, what appears to be a pretty quick burn rate, yeah? I mean,
he's actually got less cash on hand than Rubio, really than any of the top four or five candidates.
Right, and my takeaway from what I've been able to kind of look over in just today is that it seems to be just yet another example or another nail in the coffin of his supposedly inevitable nomination looks farther and farther away, and it looks like I might actually lose that bet that we set, which of course doesn't make me happy. But I guess I might be eating my words here in a minute. I don't really see if anybody else here has any sort of way forward they see for him. I'd be interested to hear about, because so far I don't see it. Especially, like I was saying, with this burnout rate he has.
Yeah, there was a great article in Politico today about the fact that Jeb Bush is now basically cutting back on all of his expenses, and he's not taking planes, he's driving cars places before. And you know, for anybody else, that's, hey, I'm being responsible with my money, which is how Jeb Bush is trying to spin it. But for him, it's kind of a death knell and indicates some fairly serious problems. It's a problem. It definitely is a problem that he's not able to. You know, his whole thing was he was going to be able to essentially.
The problem is that I'm going to be out $100 here. That's the problem. I think it's you, isn't it?
No, I don't think it was me.
Somebody on the show I made the $100 bet with, stupidly.
No, it was me.
Oh, yeah.
It's totally me.
It was me.
It was me. I took Rubio. You took the whole field.
He has the network in place. He has the fundraising in place. He's awful. He's just really bad at it.
Hey, it's commercial break. You can ask me questions, too.
No, you're done. Bill's done.
Bill, we noticed how rapidly you were watching the Chevy commercial earlier. You were like looking at it the way a dog looks at like a TV commercial for Milk Bones. It was amazing.
He's not listening to you now because the game's back on.
Oh, it is.
So, Brent, let's...
Commercial break's over. Becky and I are out.
I do want to hear if anybody on this panel can offer a way forward for Jeb Bush. I don't see it. Does anybody here see it?
No, he's not a tortoise candidate. He's got to be the hare. He's got to be out in front, or he's done.
Did you not hear my suggestion about deranged madmen gunning down other candidates?
I tend to block you out, Neal. It's no offense, but could you walk me through that?
No, that's fine. That's fair.
Oh, don't be like that. Don't go away, Matt. Just go away.
I'm not mad. No.
So, Brent, let's go to you. And did you happen to see everybody saw kind of the 15-second clip of this, but Rand Paul's weird day-long live stream that he had earlier this week, and kind of the viral clip is where he said, yeah, I'm still running for president, that's why I'm still doing this dumbass live stream that apparently his campaign foisted on him. Talk a little bit, and I have to try to get my – something's going wrong with my computer. I got to plug it in here. But talk a little bit about Rand Paul's campaign. Where do they go from here? Do you think that he's actually going to make it even to Iowa with the money that he has and his burn rate?
He may be the next person to drop out. One, he's got an incredibly high burn rate with low fundraising totals, which isn't going to work, obviously. And I don't think he's got a huge amount of PAC support. Rand only really had one issue that he was kind of running on. He was civil liberties. He was privacy. He was, you know, screw the NSA. He was that guy. And it just hasn't resonated at all. With Trump blowing into the race like the Kool-Aid man coming in through a wall with his immigration and you know, kind of populist approach, Rand really, he's just, the steam's completely come out of his sails. I'm honestly surprised that he's lasted this long, and it would not surprise me at all if he was the next guy to drop out.
And plus, let's go back to Jeff here. I mean, Rand has probably the most compelling reason of any of the remaining candidates to drop out early, right? I mean, because Rubio has essentially said he's given up. He's not going to run for his Senate seat again. Nobody else is going to run. And Rand still has kind of this ongoing feud with the Kentucky GOP about scheduling a separate caucus or convention for him apart from the other primaries. So. Yeah,
I'm sorry. I was reacting badly to something happening on the Mets game. Like Bill and Becket are. But as I was saying,
don't put
this
on me. Don't put this on me.
No, it's your fault. Well, actually, it would be Bill's fault if Bill could unmute his goddamn microphone. But it doesn't really matter. To answer the question about Rand, yeah, he's gonna have to drop out. He's gonna have to drop out because he doesn't have any path to victory. He seems to think that he does, but he doesn't, and he actually, at a certain point, could conceivably jeopardize his Senate seat. Now, everyone, you know, looks at, like, Mitch McConnell, who ended up winning by 14 points, and it was a laugher of a race for him, and nobody even knows who's running against Rand Paul at this point in the Democratic side. But, look, you've got to pay attention to the home front and the home fires, and Rand Paul ought to adjust himself to the fact that he's going to essentially be a senator for life, if that's what he wants to be, or else he can just, you know, go home if he gets sick of it. Well, he's never going to be a president.
He doesn't have, and somebody can correct me if I'm wrong here, but he doesn't just have to worry about losing to a Democrat, which is a fairly remote possibility. He essentially still has to talk the Kentucky GOP into scheduling a completely, because
No, he's done. That's already a done deal.
That's already a done deal? Because I heard
they already converted it to a caucus, and he's actually paying for it out of his pocket.
See, I heard that they had reached that agreement in principle, but then the Kentucky GOP came back and said, no, we want you to put all this money down, and he had kind of balked at that. But
at the end of the day, he'll put the money up. I can't imagine he won't.
Yeah. Well, in any event, let's go to Neal. Neal, what do you think has been the bigger disappointment in the Republican side this year? Scott Walker or Rand Paul?
Oh, easily Scott Walker. Rand Paul never had a chance in hell.
Hang on, though.
No.
Let's recall that in March, the RCP polling average had Rand Paul tied with Jeb Bush for first at about 12 points.
yeah, the problem with that is that the libertarian moment, which people started chit-chattering about, quickly passed once we started to see ISIS over there in the Middle East and the problems with Syria and the Obama administration's foreign policy blunders kind of coming to light. You know, Obama's policies overseas probably were pretty similar to Rand's in terms of disengagement from the rest of the world. And we see what that leads to. We see it leads to children being burned alive, sold into sex slavery. We see people being crucified and beheaded. And that's our fault. That blood is on our hands for disengaging. It's going to be a national shame, actually, for many years to come. We also see Russia moving right into the power vacuum. So that's from a geopolitical standpoint, not in our interest. So, Rand was done. Rand was overcome by events, I guess is how you would put it. He was never going to be president. I actually tend to think that Rand's role is more a phase two libertarian infection of the GOP and conservative movement. Ron was phase one. He was the germination phase. He spread his kind of crazy seed all throughout. And it was, you know, it didn't take too well. Rand was going to sort of cultivate it a little bit, bring it into a little, you know, more fruit, you know, fruition there. And then it'll take some other candidate down the line to actually bring that more into a mainstream competitive libertarian candidate, I think. So, no, I didn't ever think Rand had a chance at all. So I was much more disappointed in Scott Walker, who, for all his milquetoast blandness and inability to actually stand out in the pack, did have an impressive record.
Well, you know who that candidate's going to be, right?
Who's yeah.
Take that mantle. It's going to be you.
I know.
Senator Ted Cruz?
Yeah, well, you know, I'm actually really disappointed about this because I have come to believe that if it's not going to be Donald Trump, it's probably going to be Ted Cruz. I think I've come around to thinking it'll come down between Marco Rubio and Ted Cruz, and if that happens, based on what's, you know, come to pass so far, I really can't say with any confidence that Rubio would win, which depresses me greatly. It because Ted Cruz would be an absolute disaster nationally, and it would be a complete blowout.
I think, and as much as I disagree with your assessment of Ted Cruz and like Ted Cruz, I also disagree. I think that in that contest, I think Rubio would end up.
Can you tell me why you like Ted Cruz?
We've been over this so many times.
No. I've never actually seen the gist of why you don't think he's a damn liar.
No. Hold on. Now,
why
listen.
Do you think that he's ever said a truthful word to you?
Well, he has, and he's been. Listen, here's the thing. Here's the thing about me and about Ted Cruz. And this is what frustrates me, because I'm in the seat that all these frickin' Trump voters claim that they're in. I'm ready to march to Washington and burn some shit down. I'm as pissed off at Mitch McConnell as I am at Barack Obama. And I know, hey, maybe a lot of people who are watching this, that's an unreasonable thing to think and to feel. But I'm so sick and fucking tired of the failure theater in the GOP Senate. And I've just had enough. And to me, the number one critical thing is somebody who's going to go in there and shake that shit up. And what pisses me off is that these people, the Trump voters, say, oh, well, we like him because he fights, and he hasn't done shit. Whatever you say about Ted Cruz, he has actually gone in there at the stake of his own popularity with people like you, with your fabulous hair, and gone in there and tried to shake some shit up and get involved and change the way that things are done. Yeah, and well, hey, listen, why has he failed? Because there are a preponderance of shitty senators in Washington who don't care about anything but their own jobs.
Well, and isn't it Ted Cruz's job to marshal those forces and bring them around to his way of thinking? If that's the case, if he, as a senator in the United States Senate, which is a deliberative, collaborative body, is unable to perform that basic function of politicking and bringing people around to his view, why do you think he has a chance in the general election as president?
Hey, by that same token, Neal, and you're going to laugh at me for making this comparison, but by that same token, Winston Churchill was a political failure for all the times that he ran and failed until the moment was right when people finally came around to understanding that he was correct about things.
Okay. Well, there may be a conceivable moment when Ted Cruz is the man of the hour. I can't think of it.
All right. Well, let's go back to Brent. It's been a while since we've heard from Brent in his side of the aisle. And one of the things that we've mentioned kind of in passing here is the change of the foreign policy that's gone on. And, of course, the big news with that regard is that Obama announced either yesterday or today, I've had several of these cocktails at this point, that contrary to his explicit promises, he is not withdrawing from Afghanistan. He's already blown through the deadline that he set for himself, which was 2014, and now he's essentially said, we're just going to basically stay for some undefined amount of time longer. How, if at all, do you think that will play into the 2016 election, the continued presence of the United States troops in Afghanistan, which we were, I guess, sort of expecting not to happen as the last election concluded?
Yeah, we currently have just under 10,000 troops there. He announced today that they're going to stay for a while longer. In 2016, they'll draw it down to about 5,500, and then those 5,500 will stay for some, like you said, undetermined amount of time. When he declared the war in Afghanistan over in 2014, how it plays in the presidential election, it hasn't gotten a lot of play. We've been so focused on immigration due to Trump that there hasn't been a great amount of foreign policy discussed. But at some point, it's going to get noticed because ISIS is burning the Middle East down. I mean, we're literally, you know, it's just horrific. They actually literally fed a mother her child the other day. They're crucifying people. They're burying children alive. They're selling them to sex slavery. Just these horrific things. And nobody, you know, ISIS, I don't believe, was even mentioned in the Democratic debate the other night.
Not once. And in fact, that was the impetus for the decision to keep troops in Afghanistan was the news essentially that ISIS has now moved into Afghanistan.
Right.
And out of their kind of...
We're essentially retreating in Afghanistan. We're drawing down troops and we're closing down bases and drawing further and further in. That's retreat. That's not a drawdown. That's not a we've won the war and we're slowly leaving. They're gaining ground and we're drawing down troops. That's a retreat. I've had I have family and friends in the military that have been on the ground in Iraq and Afghanistan. They're pissed, as they should be pissed. Their friends, their brothers have died in these countries, and it appears to be for nothing. We're giving it all back now. And I think there's an undercurrent of that. There's a lot of people like you, like I, that are pissed off about that. And if a Republican candidate can tap into that and do it smartly, do it at the right moment, at the right time, when an opening presents itself, then I think they'll gain some traction there. But there hasn't been a whole lot of discussion on it so far, which frankly kind of disappoints me.
So let's go to Becket. Are you with us?
Yes.
All right, Becket. So one of the things that's been the hardest to pin down for me is that I think that in the final analysis, what determines whether Republicans or Democrats win the White House, at least to a very large degree, is whether it's an economic election or whether it's a foreign policy election. And regardless of what we've seen, and it we've had some increasing alarm about what's going on in Syria, ISIS invading Afghanistan and essentially taking over there, it still isn't really catching the public's attention to such an extent that we would say right now the mood of the country is mainly focused on foreign policy like it was in, say, 2004. What's your prediction at this point as to whether 2016 is going to be primarily about economic issues or primarily about kind of the ongoing and worsening conflagration in the Middle East? How bad does it have to get before that becomes the central focus?
Well, I think, as Neal has already rightly pointed out, it is that bad already with the persecution and genocide of Christians, which should be on the forefront of everyone's mind. I think what is going to be deciding a lot of this election right now is what the candidates are going to want to advocate. Say, if Sanders continues, it will be an economic election. As you saw the other night when asked about foreign policy issues, at one point he blanked out. He wasn't even paying attention. He doesn't care, doesn't want to talk about it. Hillary Clinton, as I think I mentioned on the show last week, she certainly doesn't want to talk about it because she's intimately tied to everything that's fucked up over there right now. Rubio wants to talk about foreign policy. So you'll have this issue where you have top-tier candidates like Rubio who will be pushing foreign policy, and they're going to try to make that an issue. And then you'll have people who want to avoid it, like Hillary, and people who don't care, like Sanders. Going back to our earlier thing, whether Biden jumps in, I think that's a wild card. He can go either way on that issue, I think. His public persona, at least for the last 10 years, has been him talking about middle-class families, so he might stick to economics. What I'm generally trying to get at is right now is that there is no reason why foreign policy shouldn't be on the forefront of everyone's mind. Like, again, Neal was saying, it is that bad right now. I think what will dictate a lot of this is what the candidates want to talk about, and the reporters, the press at large will dutifully cover what they say and probably not push them as hard as we would like to see the press push them on certain issues. For instance, just to kind of round this out, I think Katie Yoder at MRC TV made a really good point in an article today about how CNN made zero effort to question any of the Democratic candidates about the Planned Parenthood scandal, even after Hillary Clinton brought it up. Like, Hillary Clinton actually brought it up and started talking about efforts to defund it, which is funny. The sidebar, she referred to it as Republicans trying to use big government to shut down Planned Parenthood. Because what's more big government than trying to defund something? But I thought it was interesting. You see, CNN didn't push on that. They didn't care. I think we will see this as well as we go forward. If a candidate doesn't want to talk about foreign policy, reporters don't care. They'll talk about her going to Chipotle. They'll talk about her her Twitter account and how she tries to connect to millennials, blah, blah, blah. They'll talk about what the candidates talk about, and I think you will see that as well with the Republicans. If Rubio wants to hammer foreign policy, people will report it, but I don't think you will see any, just to your broader question, I think the campaign on both sides will be dictated by what the candidates want to talk about, not by what they should be talking about.
So Jeff, let me go to you and
Leon, if I can jump in for just a second.
Sure.
He mentioned Rubio. You and I were both at the Red State gathering. Rubio was very on point with foreign policy. He seemed very, very well spoken, very well versed in a lot of subjects, but especially on foreign policy, and which is interesting because he comes across as so young, and you would think that's something he needs a lot of experience in. But I think he is a candidate because of his confidence, because of his basis of knowledge that could actually jump in on foreign policy and actually make an impact there.
Yeah.
Brent, I'm sorry. I have to jump in and just say that Daniel Murphy is a goddamn hero.
I know, right? Look, do you see that?
By the way, I'm about
Let's
20 minutes.
Go I'm about Mets! Let's go Mets!
First of all, you're dyslexic and that's backwards.
No, it's not. I wrote it backwards so it would play forwards. I hope that works.
No. But Daniel Murphy's a Jacksonville kid, which is about 20 minutes south of where I am right now.
No kidding.
So Jeff, let's go back to you and...
Yeah.
Let's say that something happens that basically forces the national attention towards foreign policy. Let's say there's another major terrorist attack on American soil, God forbid, nuclear explosion somewhere in the Middle East, something like that, to where the candidates have no choice but to talk about foreign policy as kind of the main issue of the day. In such a scenario, I mean, is there any chance that any of the Democrats come out okay? And the reason I ask this is I think that the most asinine answer of the entire Democrat debate was Hillary Clinton's answer on Libya, which almost no one is talking about, where she said, oh, well, the thing about the Arab Spring is that it caused the Libyans to democratically elect a bunch of moderates, and then some radicals took over. I mean, it was just the most insane answer that anyone could possibly come up with. Can any of the Democrats in the field survive if something like that happens and the focus turns to national security?
Sure. Yeah, and you know why they can survive? For the simple reason that the world is not as we wish it would be, and voters are simply not as focused on foreign policy as they have been. Frankly, voters have almost rarely, if ever, been focused on foreign policy. I think there's only one election in my lifetime, certainly only one election within the last 50 years that could be credibly argued to have been a foreign policy election, and that was 2004. And that was because 9/11 was just still so fresh in most of our memories. I think it's entirely possible that things can continue to go straight to hell in the Middle East. And the fact that Obama has, you know, I have come to believe this is almost a conscious strategy on his part, that he's been completely unwilling to accept any responsibility or blame for it, allows the Democrats to say, whatever, we don't have any issues here, we're not responsible for it, we don't have to have any plans. And every time the Republicans bring it up, it's going to be a big buzzkill for a number of, like, squishy voters who just want to think about, abortion or, gay marriage or whatever sort of boring domestic issue that's far more comfortable to worry about than the idea of ISIS sweeping the Middle East and, burying young babies and nailing Christians to crosses. So, yes, I absolutely do think that they can survive everything going to hell. Because I think that to argue otherwise is to overestimate, frankly, the place that the American voting public is at right now.
All right. Well, we are going to move to our final topic of the night. All of us on this particular podcast, as you can probably tell from what everyone is doing right now, we all love America, which is to say that we love the game of baseball. And we want to talk a little bit about what's become a semi-controversial event and one of the most crazy innings of baseball I've ever seen, the Joey Bautista bat flip. And I'm just cueing Aaron that I want him to get the clip ready. I'm not ready for it now, but just if he can get the clip ready, we're going to show it here in just a little bit. Setting the stage, a very crazy inning in an elimination game between the Texas Rangers and the Toronto Blue Jays, in which a baseball – in the top of the inning, it was tied 2-2. The Rangers went ahead on a play that I have never seen at any level of playing or coaching baseball, and I've been obsessively following this game since I was 8. Basically, the Toronto Blue Jays catcher, Russell Martin, was throwing the ball back to the pitcher, and lo and behold, it happened to kind of out of nowhere strike Shin-Soo Chu, who was standing in the batter's box, and caromed off toward third base. The Rangers base runner, Odor, was standing on third, alertly ran home. Everyone was confused. Nobody knew what the rule was. They went and looked it up and found out that it turns out But lo and behold, there is actually a major league rule that covers the situation, and it's a live ball when that happens, and the run was allowed to score. Now, I say all of that to set this up because I think it's necessary to understand what happened with the Joey Bautista, or I call him Joey Bautista. Joey Bats is his nickname. Jose Bautista with the bat flip. Because after that happens, and if you just see the bat flip, you don't understand kind of the emotions that led to that particular moment. After that happened, the Toronto crowd, full of Canadians of all people, went absolutely batshit insane. I would never have predicted that Canadians could even behave in this way, like physically. Like, I would have thought that they would be physically incapable, just throwing trash onto the field.
Oh, they rioted. They rioted in Vancouver when the Canucks lost the Stanley Cup Finals, and things burned to the ground in Vancouver. So yeah, Canadians can do it with hockey, but not usually with baseball.
Yeah, over baseball, there's very nearly a riot in the stands. Play was stopped for 28 minutes before they could restore order and the players could take the field again. So that was kind of the emotion. The players were all upset. The crowd was charged to an unbelievable level. The Rangers now have a lead. They're going in. The Blue Jays come up to bat, and the Rangers boot three very easy plays in a row to load the bases. They still look like they're possibly going to get out of this with a tie. Jose Bautista, who has spent his entire career playing for shitty baseball teams, and before he became a star, bounced up and down in the minors for many years, hit a home run, and then did this. Aaron, can you give us the bat flip? Guys, I watch a lot of baseball, as I said. My favorite team is the Boston Red Sox. I'm very familiar with the bat flip that hitters do after the home run. I've never seen one that, I guess, exuberant. And, of course, it's a matter of controversy today for anybody who follows baseball. Everyone is talking about it. Was it the right thing to do? Was it the wrong thing to do? Brent, what are your thoughts on Jose Bautista's bat flip here? I know you're also a guy who's played and coached baseball for a number of years. You think it was okay, not okay? What do you think was going on with that? Because of course, after this, you know, we almost had a couple of fights on the field that kind of charged up the emotions a little more. We had, after basically two almost fights on the field after that home run.
Yeah, like you said, I played and coached for a long time, for about 20 years, and I spent most of that time pitching or as a pitching coach. So I am not a fan of the bat flip in general. I understand all the unwritten rules about showing up pitchers and pitchers showing up hitters and all that kind of stuff. I got to be honest, I don't have a problem with this one. Like you said, you set up the whole situation. The whole place was crazy. It was nuts. It wasn't Barry Bonds. It wasn't Sammy Sosa. It wasn't a performance. It wasn't some, you know, end zone dance that they were doing with the bat and the twirl and all that crap. He literally hit the ball, looked at the pitcher, and just tossed the bat. Oh, my God, look what I just did. So typically, I'm not a fan of the flip at all. I think it's kind of Bush League. But in this instance, it's just pure emotion. It's no different than Cueto coming off the mound, you know, pounding himself on the chest after a big inning. When it's just pure kind of instantaneous emotion like that, and it wasn't completely over the top, he didn't take 4 years to round the bags, he wasn't talking to the pitcher on the way, he threw the bat, he took off, he ran around the bases. I really don't have much of a problem with it.
Can we agree, though, that Fernando Rodney should be suspended for 5 games every time he shoots an arrow into the sky after leaving the mound?
Can we agree that he should be suspended for life until he decides to wear his hat right?
I mean, yes, that too, but we're going to start with the more egregious issue, because that's the most annoying celebration I have ever seen any baseball player.
You know what what I would have been the most ticked about in that entire situation is when the ball hit Sin Chu Young Fat, holy fuck, when it hit him and went down to third base.
Shin Su Chu, good Lord.
Yeah. When it hit him and went down to third base, the home plate umpire immediately came out and was waving the play dead. Immediately. The player, the runner from third base crosses the plate, and the infield never moved. They never even made it.
You know what, though? They were never
going to make that play.
You're right. They're probably not. But when the umpire comes out and waves the play
dead. No, I saw. By the time he went like this, the guy was already 3/4 of the way home. There was no way they were going to make that play.
He was instantaneously waving that play off. It'd be no different than an NFL game. If they call the runner, if they call the running back down by contact, the guy picks it up, runs it back for the touchdown, they stop him. Oh, wait, it was a fumble, and we're giving you the touchdown. You don't do that. You get the ball where, you know, where it was
fumbled. They do, though, allow them now to that used to be once the whistle is blown, you know, forget it. You know, we can't review that. But they do now allow to say if it's clear that the team recovered it, that we're going to allow them to go ahead and have the ball. And I think in this case, it was clear Odor was going to score. Becket, you guys are watching there. You got any thoughts on the Bautista bat flip? And I guess what annoys me as a guy who played baseball, not as a pitcher, is I think there's a double standard for the amount of emotion that batters are supposed to show versus what pitchers are supposed to show, right? I mean, we talked about Cueto pounding his chest. I mean, pitchers all the time, if they feel like upset about something that a batter did, even if it's just hitting a home run and not trotting too fast, they're allowed under these stupid unwritten rules of baseball to basically punk the next guy. And this is what's bullshit to me, Brent, is why, and this I've actually stood in the batter's box against a guy who was a future major league pitcher who was throwing 94 miles an hour at that time.
Which pitcher?
Jamie Wright. Went to the high school across. He's kind of wandered through them. He's probably still pitching at the age of 40 by now, for all I know. Never has been very good, but he's kind of hung on. And you know, it's a terrifying experience as a batter to just stand there when a guy is pumping 95 down there. I think it's bullshit that the answer is, I hit a home run off of you, so now you're going to try to injure me. I mean, look, if you had one of those buzz by your head, your life flashes before your eyes. Okay. I mean, that's fucked up. How about instead you do better? How about instead you pitch better next time and don't let me hit a home run? Why isn't that the response?
Here's one thing. You're headhunting, complete bullshit. I am never, ever, ever in favor of buzzing a guy, of headhunting, because you're literally putting his life in jeopardy there. That is not okay. Headhunting, it was never part of my game. Plunking a guy, hitting him in the butt, hitting him in the legs, it's a bruise. He'll get over it. And maybe I'll tell you one of the very few times that I actually buzzed somebody, that I put somebody down, and again, I did not go headhunting. I simply buzzed him, was because he was peeking. He's a batter standing in the batter's box, peeking back at the catcher, trying to pick up signals. That's as dirty as it gets from a batter. I buzzed him. You know what he did? He stopped peeking. That's just part of baseball.
You think you're going to hit the guy in the butt.
One of the things about baseball is that it has these sort of self-policing rules in it. And like what Bill was talking about with the slide and everything, I'm honestly surprised that the Mets didn't retaliate. I was arguing in favor of that. It's kind of like you see in years ago, at least in hockey, how they started phasing out fights. I think it's actually important and good that you let players kind of self-police themselves within reason. Of course, you don't pop a 95-mile-per-hour ball to a guy's head, of course. That's criminal. That's almost manslaughter.
Becket, you're a real brawler, aren't you? That's why you like fights, right?
I love the Broad Street
Bull. You like to settle disputes with your fists.
But no, that's actually safer that way. Otherwise, you get, like, especially in hockey, this is a great example, that when you don't let them duke it out anymore, now not quite Broad Street Bully style. You don't have to be, you know, like Machine Gun whatever the hell is it, Kelly, Machine Gun Kelly. But at some point, you let them get it out of their system, and they, because I played rugby, I played baseball. I'm sure you guys all played some sports. He was talking about baseball. Sometimes you kind of get it out of your system. Otherwise, when you have some of these cheap plays and stuff, and then you're not allowed to do anything, that gets pent up, and that's when you actually, especially in hockey, that's when you get the really dirty cheap shots. When you have guys pent up with grudges, and it gets nasty out there.
Well, that's what's fucked up about the whole quote-unquote self-policing in baseball. And again, this is my perspective as a guy who's, you know, played catcher and not, you know, pitcher. You know, it's why is it okay that a pitcher throws at me? And again, I know he says he's throwing at my butt, but look, no pitcher has that control. He could hit my ribs. He could hit my elbow. He could injure me. Oh, I mean, I've been injured.
No pitcher has that control? Are you kidding me?
No, I mean, look, it's... Hey, not every pitch that you throw is going to go where you want it to go, even major leaguers. I mean, that's just the fact. That, you know, the ball slips, you miss location by a few inches, and that's no longer on a nice soft spot of, you know, muscle and fat. It's on a bone, and I'm out and injured for a few weeks. So fine. If you're going to let pitchers do that, let batters charge the mound, right? So a pitcher does that.
You know what the answer to that is? Screw the DH. The hitter, the pitcher has to come to the plate. Then he has to face justice.
But
that's why I love the National League, because and you know what? The pitchers in the National League aren't as crazy about that crap, because they know that it's going to come around to their turn.
It's not true, though. I mean, if you look, there's been statistical analysis. There's not a meaningful difference between hit by pitches in the American League and the National League. It just doesn't. You would think that it's true. Huh? It's true. It's true.
You take your sabermetrics and you get out of here.
Me with facts. I just don't look. And I especially don't get, you know, I did something bad that's pissed you off as a pitcher, so you're going to hit somebody else on my team. That's going to be your retaliation. I mean, it's all bullshit to me. Neal, what do you think about this whole situation? You've been very quiet.
I enjoy watching baseball in person, not on television. I have no strong feelings one way or the other about various baseball arcana. But I enjoy listening to men who know what they're talking about discuss the issues with verve and vigor. Continue, gentlemen.
Can we just point out that Bill is mopping up all of the beer he just spilled in the background?
It's award-winning internet television that we're participating in here, ladies and gentlemen. All right, well, we're out of time. I've got to get going here. We want to thank our panelists for being here,
Leon, yeah? You know I'm not going to let you go without a poem. You know it's not going to happen.
No one,
an ode to my friends at BATF, to Leon, Neal, Bill Becket, and Jeff. First to Leon, sipping his gin and juice, always so fancy-free and footloose. Then to T. Becket, so well-dressed and no patience for fools. Ah, crap, I can't see him. Can someone get him a step stool? On to Neal, so full of dashing and dare, but somewhere a poodle yells, oh my God, he stole my hair. To Bill and his beer, we raise our glass while thinking to ourselves, good God, what a smart ass. And finally, Jeff, every rhino's favorite darling boy. But I wonder, does he know the Proto-Indo-European basis for joy? Now, as much fun as we're having, all good things must end. Joking aside, I consider them all to be a good man and friend. And if we should drink together, we'll avoid what's trendy and hot. We'll simply say, fuck it, and order a shot.
That was actually legitimately great.
Yes, yes. Normally, well, your poetry is very terrible. But tonight it was good, Brent. Thank you very much for
that
contribution.
That is really, really awful tequila. God.
All right, so we're going to close off for the night. Let me thank my panelists for being here. Becket Adams from the Washington Examiner, F. Bill McMorris, who was sort of here tonight. Thank you guys for being here, taking time out of your Mets game. Thank you, Jeff Blehar, the Ace of Spades Decision Desk. Neal Dewing of the Federalist, glad to have you back with us. Say hello to Ted Cruz for us. And thank you, Brent Cochran of the Ace of Spades Decision Desk and also of the Drift Compatible Podcast. Appreciate you, the audience, for hanging in there with us, even though we started late. Thanks, Aaron, for all his work that he does producing for us. And we hope to see you next week on the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Friends.